The Amarna aftermath, circa 1341 to 1336 BC. And I should add from the outset that those dates are only approximate. No one, especially Egyptologists, agree on the absolute dates. The main characters involved are Akhenaten, Smenkhare, and Neferneferuaten, or Nefertiti. The latter days of Akhenaten's reign and their immediate aftermath have taxed Egyptologists for generations, yet the basic sequence of events is straightforward. Akhenaten died, for reasons unknown, and was buried at Amarna, joining the body of his mother Tiye. He may already have been ruling with a co-regent called Smenkhare, but he too appears to have died. Regardless of what happened after Akhenaten's death, including the mysterious possible rule by Nefertiti briefly and the rearrangement of some of the burials, the outcome was the accession of Tutankhamun, who changed his name to Tutankhamun. The end of the Amarna interlude is obsessively pursued by scholars engaged in a ceaseless debate. The controversies serve little purpose because the evidence does not exist to resolve them. If we set aside the more eccentric cul-de-sacs, flights of fancy, and other indulgences that have plagued the study of this period, the essential story emerges as being relatively simple. It boiled down to who was going to rule Egypt and undo Akhenaten's revolution. Most of the intractable scholarly problems had very few, if any, consequences, regardless of how they are interpreted, thanks to so many of the key players disappearing in short order. The only individuals of any importance left when the dust settled were Tutankhamun, Akhenaten, an elderly official called I, and a general called Horemheb. In the latter part of Akhenaten's reign, Smenkhare came into view, but only just. His unusual name had been used once before in Egyptian royal history during the 13th dynasty. Like all such names, the precise meaning is opaque. One possibility is the soul of Re is vigorous, another the soul of Re is ennobled. But he was most usually referred to by his throne name, Ankheperure, living other manifestations of Re. There is no other figure in Egyptology for whom the emergence of unequivocal information about who he was, what he was, and what happened to him would not cause a greater sigh of relief among students of this period. Sadly, it seems that day, if it ever comes, is a long way off. The enigma is not unusual. Egyptian history is filled with individuals known only from one or two references. In an ideal world, Smenkhare could be forgotten about immediately. Unfortunately, although his role was little more than a walk-on one, he played an important part in the Amarna finale. He is most likely to have been a brother or a son of Akhenaten, the latter being much harder to reconcile with the timescale, his age at death, and the length of Akhenaten's reign. However, he is unknown from any earlier reference to his presence at the Amarna court or before. This means we do not know for certain who his parents were. The most obvious candidates are Amenhotep III and Tiye, except that she may have been too old, or Amenhotep III and a lesser but unknown wife. A brief outline of events. On the 14th of May 1338 BC, in what might have been Akhenaten's 15th regnal year, this depends entirely on the chronology being followed, a total eclipse of the sun cast its shadow over Amarna. It took place a little after midday, just over 5 weeks prior to the summer solstice, which means that the sun was close to being directly overhead. Totality lasted about 4 minutes and 50 seconds. Since we can be as good as certain that the sky was free of clouds, this extraordinary event must have been as overwhelming as it is possible for an eclipse to be, especially at Akhetaten. The path of totality did not pass over Thebes. Whether this eclipse happened in Akhenaten's 15th regnal year or not is unlikely ever to be known, or what impact it had in a city built around the worship of the sun. No Egyptian record of the event is known. Given the emphasis placed by Akhenaten on the art and light, the blotting out of the sun cannot have seemed like approval, if it took place during his reign. Conversely, it could be argued that the eclipse took place much earlier in his reign and was the basis of moving to Akhetaten. But in a historical era of endless uncertainty, it's moderately gratifying to know at least that this event occurred at that moment in time and at that place. Smenkhare apparently ruled alongside Akhenaten briefly as a co-regent and as king married Meriatartin, cementing the union. They appear, at one time their names still just barely legible, in the tomb of Merire II at Amarna, that's tomb TA2. Smenkhare had one known monument at Amarna, a hall attached to Akhenaten's great palace identified from bricks bearing the name Ankheperure. Ankheperure and Meriatartan were also named on gold sequins on a linen garment that ended up in Tutankhamun's tomb. As a princess, Meriatartan could not, if family tradition was followed, have married Smenkhare unless he was a king in his own right. One of the very few pieces of evidence that might support the idea of a co-regency is a globular calcite vase from Tutankhamun's tomb bearing a largely erased inscription. This has been restored to show the names of Akhenaten and Smenkhare side by side. If that seems tenuous, indeed it is, but in Amarna studies, such examples carry enormous weight. There is no doubt that the two pairs of kings' cartouches were shown, and the restoration is not inconsistent with their names. But the truth is that the surviving hieroglyphs are extremely difficult to see, and most of what was there has disappeared. The heavily restored names were produced without the benefit of either direct physical examination of the vase or the production of very high-quality photographs, or scientific examination. Since Ankheperure was also associated with a later form of Nefertiti's name, Neferneferuaten, the idea emerged among some Egyptologists that Smenkhare was Nefertiti. This argument relied on identifying the body in the mysterious tomb KV55 as Akhenaten, something which has not escaped criticism because it appears to be of someone too young. But then, to be fair, almost no argument in Amarna studies ever does. More recently, it was noticed that Ankheperure also occasionally appeared in the female form Anketkheperure, and that when associated with Neferneferuaten, it always had one of several epithets, unlike when it was used by Smenkhare. The collective result is now that some Egyptologists have reached the conclusion that Smenkhare Ankheperure died during Akhenaten's reign in about the 15th regnal year. At this point, he was replaced as king by Nefertiti. She was already called Neferneferuaten, but this was augmented with various significant epithets and the adoption of Smenkhare's throne name, sometimes in the female form, perhaps to maintain continuity. A stela found at Amarna was modified so that her single name cartouche as queen was adapted into the double cartouche of a king. The normal queenly title, Great Royal Wife, was obscured by the addition suitable for a king. Correspondingly, a strip of wood from a box found in the filling of the entrance to Tutankhamun's tomb describes and names both Akhenaten and Neferneferuaten as kings, and Meriatartan as Great Royal Wife, their daughter thus apparently serving them both in that formal capacity. It was a new variant on how Sitamun had served her father Amenhotep III, Sitamun, of course, being Akhenaten's sister. The inscription doesn't mention Smenkhare, which is difficult to account for unless he was already dead. Although the idea that Neferneferuaten was Nefertiti and not Smenkhare was always one of the most likely explanations, it's typical of Egyptology that confirmation has been sought by an arcane route. The unusual and unparalleled epithet that appears with the name sometimes has now been translated as effective for her husband. It's rarely the case in Egyptology that such phrases or epithets are straightforward, and this is no exception. The first two hieroglyphs can indeed mean effective, profitable, or useful, with the second sign, T, feminizing the term. They can also mean become a spirit. The three hieroglyphs, translated as for her husband, are consistent with the phrase meaning effective for her husband. However, without the determinative sign for a man, the three can also function in that combination and order as the single word awake or resurrect, which of course would fit well with the become a spirit meaning of the first part. The ambiguity is a common consequence of the abbreviated ways Egyptian could be written, and where the correct meaning might have been obvious at the time, but not necessarily now. This is an instance where the phrase involved, especially as it's unknown elsewhere, cannot be translated in any unequivocal way, and where quite possibly the precise meaning is beyond us to grasp. The only element of the epitaph that really matters is the feminizing element, because this would seem to suggest it cannot be describing a male, regardless of what it meant. However, on the precedent of Hatshepsut and her use of male and female titles, not only for herself but also her father and brother, it's impossible to be too rigid about this. Nonetheless, as a king, and with Meriatartan reprising her role as great royal wife now to her mother and father, it appears that Nefertiti ruled Egypt briefly with Akhenaten until he died in his 17th regnal year or not long after. A curiosity is that Nefertiti was unmentioned by name in the Amarna letters, but Meriatartan seems to turn up twice in them, called Mayatu, but at an earlier date. She's referred to in letters to Akhenaten, specifically as his daughter, and was clearly regarded as a figure of note, to whom gifts were sent. In one of these two instances, a reference to the mistress of the house is the only possible acknowledgement of Nefertiti, who is explicitly distinguished from Maiatu. 17 years was a long time for a radical revolutionary to have ruled, especially if his reign had been tainted by the active suppression of any opponents. There is, however, no evidence at all to support the theory that Akhenaten headed a form of religious totalitarianism. He allowed the other temples to fall into decay and the name of Amun to be defaced, but that's not the same as tearing them down, which was instead exactly what his opponents did after his death to his temples and monuments. Instead, he had withdrawn himself and his court to a new home rather than seeking outright confrontation. In this version of events, Nefertiti continued as king of Egypt briefly, perhaps overseeing the accession of Tutankhamun, but before long had disappeared too, as had Meriatartan. That she never appears with her name modified to Meriatarmun makes it unlikely she survived much beyond Tutankhamun's accession and his name change to Tutankhamun. Given Nefertiti's prominence from the outset of the reign, serving effectively as a joint monarch with Akhenaten, it would have been logical for her to continue to rule on her own after his death. The discovery of a scarab bearing the name Neferuata Nefertiti in a shipwreck at Uluburun off the Turkish coast has been treated by some as evidence of her sending out an embassy to the Hittites during this time. It was recovered with a collection of material that included two Near Eastern cylinder seals. Several other Egyptian items were recovered from the site, which included at least two probable second intermediate period scarabs and an 18th dynasty steatite plaque inscribed to Ptah. This is better evidence for the scarab just forming part of the stock of a member of the ship's crew who had bought it in Egypt while in a port, intending to sell it on as a curio. It has no other significance. The shattered fragments of Akhenaten's grave goods, including over 200 shabtis and pieces of a canopic chest in the royal tomb, Tiye 26 at Amarna, as well as structural modifications made to accommodate his shrines, make it as good as certain that he died at Akhenaten and was buried there. This would have been just as he had wished, joining his mother Tiye, who died a few years before, and likewise his daughter Meketaten. All three were subsequently disinterred and the tomb emptied and desecrated. The well shaft was filled with rubble and bricks to facilitate the removal of burials and funerary equipment from the main burial chamber. The burial chamber's decoration was entirely Artanist in theme, based on what little survives, and there seemed to have been no niches for the four magic birth bricks, whose spells would have had no currency in Atenite ideology. Only Tiye's reburial at Thebes can be tracked. Smenkhare's burial place has not been found, assuming he had one. Tantalisingly, three unfinished tombs close to the royal tomb at Amarna are known, but not who they were intended for. If it's Smenkhare's body that was found in tomb KV55 at Thebes, then he too had been disinterred and moved unless he died at Thebes. The latter is a possibility. Death from natural causes is certainly the simplest explanation for Akhenaten's disappearance by his 17th regnal year. Naturally, we have no way of knowing how Akhenaten died. There is nothing to substantiate suicide or assassination, especially the latter, though it's a serious possibility. There is good evidence, including a deep cut to the neck on his body, that Ramesses III of the 20th dynasty was murdered as part of a palace conspiracy. He was by no means as controversial a figure as Akhenaten. There are other examples across history of monarchs, especially those who were inadequate or who imposed unwelcome change, being assassinated by plots. Among other deaths, the Ptolemaic dynasty saw the probable murder of Ptolemy III by a lover and her brother, the poisoning of his sister-wife Arsinoe, and the murder of Ptolemy V. However, the circumstantial evidence of the physical remains now believed by some to be Nefertiti's is that she died violently, though the limited historical evidence means that this must have come later than Akhenaten's death. If Tutankhamun was considered old enough to be planted on the throne, then that might have been all those who were desperate to remove Akhenaten needed. The only direct evidence is the speed with which normal service was resumed. That smacks of a plan born out of an anxious desire for an opportunity to restore the old ways. There is a classic instance of how a single graffito can serve as a crucial piece of evidence. Found on the wall of a tomb at Western Thebes, TT139, it was written in the third regnal year of the reign of Neferneferuaten. There's no reference to Akhenaten, who'd presumably died. The text refers to a priest of Amun called Pawa, who was blind, the graffito being written for him by his brother. The two served in the Kewet of Ankheperure at Thebes. In the context of a royal name, Kewet means, most probably, the name of a royal mortuary cult. The lack of an epithet suggests the cult was that of Smenkhore, but it doesn't matter. The important point is that here we have a priest of Amun working with his brother in the memorial mortuary cult of a temple of either of the last rulers of the Amarna phase. It would also appear that either observances of Amun had continued surreptitiously or were now resuming openly under Neferneferuaten. This continued under Tutankhamun. That short summary makes sense of the limited and confusing evidence, but that doesn't mean it's correct. The narrative also passes over an almost unbelievable litany of bewildering arguments conducted almost without exception inconclusively. There is still a school of thought wedded to the idea that Smenkhore and Nefertiti were the same person. The most obvious point of all is usually overlooked, regardless of the roles they fulfilled. Akhenaten, Smenkhore, Nefertiti and Meriatartin all disappeared quickly from the scene. They left only one dynastic candidate who was available to become king, the 8 or 9 year old Tutankhamun, and Meriatartin's younger sister, Ankhesenpaaten, perhaps a couple of years older, to be his queen. If any tears were wept for Akhenaten beyond his immediate family circle, they soon evaporated as mercenary court mourners quickly repositioned themselves. The wind was changing in Egypt. Tutankhamun and his queen were the figureheads of a new administration that began the systematic, but not comprehensive, removal of Atenist monuments, and ordered the restoration of temples of traditional cults, especially those of Amun. The strange case of the tomb known as KV55. In the murky drama of Akhenaten's last days and the first few years of Tutankhamun's reign, the adult male body found in the small and scrappy Valley of the King's Tomb, known as KV55, and its wrecked contents are never offstage. It lies only about 120 feet, 36 metres, across the valley floor from Tutankhamun's tomb. No other two 18th dynasty tombs are so close to one another. The assemblage has foxed Egyptologists ever since its discovery, many convinced that solving the riddle of the body's identity is the holy grail that will transform our knowledge of the immediate aftermath of Akhenaten's reign. The argument, increasingly bolstered by recent scientific evidence which has only muddied the waters further, has rumbled on ever since the tomb was found. KV55 was a repository of material and several burials brought from Amarna in the aftermath of Akhenaten's reign. We have no idea what happened to some of the other burials from there, notably Meketaten's and probably two of her sisters. They have never been found. The tomb only consists of an entrance corridor, a rectangular burial chamber, and a small niche annex. There were no wall paintings or reliefs or texts such as graffiti. It was in an appalling state when found in 1907. It had suffered in the first instance from a chaotic burial of several individuals, then subsequent intrusions and extractions of bodies and funerary equipment, as well as deliberate damage. What was left behind was further damaged by water ingress and structural collapse. The tomb had the misfortune to be found by a team working for a wealthy American hobbyist Egyptologist called Theodore Davis, who pressurized them to make an impatient removal of the contents. These were not recorded properly, or even a plan made, permanently compromising analysis of the tomb's contents, though sterling efforts have made good some of the lost information. Nevertheless, the tomb yielded some remarkably useful evidence and material. There were two clear phases: burial of the original assemblage and partial clearance, which left it in the state it was found in 1907. The most conspicuous relics were panels from a gilded wooden shrine that had belonged to Tiye and been commissioned for her by Akhenaten. The shrine had been in the process of being removed, but the job was abandoned when it became too difficult to drag the panels up through the corridor. They were left where they lay. The shrine components were damaged, but they still bore scenes decorated with figures of Akhenaten and Tiye. Akhenaten's name and figure had been erased, but Ti's name and Amenhotep III's remained, as did the two names of the Aten in their late form and the image of the Aten. In an interesting twist, Amenhotep III's throne name, Neb-Mart-Re, which appears on the shrine, was formed out of phonetic hieroglyphs, reading Neb-Mart-Re, that avoid using the normal anthropomorphic sign for the goddess Mart. This might have offended Akhenaten's religious sensibilities when the shrine was made, presumably at Amarna. There were four magic mud bricks that belonged to Akhenaten still in their niches. His throne name was still visible on two of the bricks, but was identifiable, principally on the first, though traces of damage suggest a perfunctory effort was made to re-raise it. Such bricks were a common inclusion in New Kingdom tombs and carry protective spells connected to birth, and thus the rebirth of the deceased. The texts on these bricks were the conventional ones from chapter 151 of the Book of the Dead. For example, the spells are similar, but not identical, to those from the tomb of Thutmose IV. The Aten is, of course, unmentioned. Akhenaten, whose name was therefore only given as his throne name Neferkapurure, was also labelled on one brick as Osiris, thus referring to his having died. Conversely, Thutmose IV's magic bricks included both his birth and throne names. The tomb contained a royal coffin. The names had been removed. Inside the coffin was a badly preserved mummy, now known to be that of an adult male. The only names still visible on gold foil with the mummy were those of the Aten. Anything that might have identified the body had been carefully removed. There were also four canopic jars, each bearing portrait bust stoppers of a woman wearing the Nubian wig, popular towards the end of the 18th dynasty. Each bust had been modified by adding the Uraeus cobra symbol of royalty. The inscriptions on the jars had been deliberately rubbed off, with only traces remaining. There were other items, but few were inscribed. Those that were mostly carried the names of Tiye and or Amenhotep III, including a stone vase with both his names. The sole exceptions were a collection of clay seals bearing Tutankhamun's throne name, Nebkepurure. There were no objects that carried Smenkhare or Nefertiti's names, or their throne name, Ankhetepurure. Nor was there anything that could be linked to Meriatartin or other members of the Amarna royal family. The tomb, when discovered, only housed remnants of what had once been placed there. This inevitably means that any conclusions drawn solely from the contents may well be wide of the mark, since we have no idea what had been removed during the clearance episode. So much for what we know. What we can infer takes the story a little further. The battered shrine panels are of dimensions compatible with a restoration of Tiye's sarcophagus, based on the fragments found in the royal tomb at Amarna. Presumably then, Tiye was first buried at Amarna, but when the city was abandoned, she was removed along with the shrine and her other burial goods and taken to Thebes for reburial in KV55. Tutankhamun's seals make it likely this occurred during his reign and on his orders. The magic bricks of Akhenaten, being conventional in form and text, are unlikely to have been taken from Amarna, where the burial chamber does not apparently even have the necessary niches in each of the four walls. They were probably made at Thebes for KV55, in the knowledge or belief that the body was being reburied was Akhenaten's. This doesn't preclude the possibility of the burial or reburial of other individuals in KV55 as part of the process, but only the one male body remained. The bust stopper portraits on each of the four canopic jars resembled relief carvings depicting Kia, Akhenaten's lesser wife. The erased inscriptions left traces compatible with the names of Aten, Akhenaten, and a reference to Kia's unique title, Greatly Beloved Wife. However, the traces really are just that. The only part of Kia's titles detectable on the jars now are the signs for wife, which cannot be regarded as definitive on their own. Kia's personal name is not visible. The basis of the attribution to her relies on the rest of the restored inscription resembling, or at least not conflicting with, a complete version on an unprovenanced calcite unguent jar which does name her, and the jar stopper portraits. The deletion of her name was probably to ready the jars for use in KV55 for the male burial. Nothing survived on KV55's coffin to confirm whose it had been, and nor did anything that would have identified the actual occupant. However, the inscriptions have lent themselves to various reconstructions. One of the most convincing is that the coffin was originally made for a lesser wife of a king. Her names were then removed, and the inscriptions modified for a king with his name in cartouches, replacing hers, and epithets added. The technicalities of the altered text are extremely complicated, but because of her canopic jars, they amount to the most likely original owner being Kia, after which the coffin was repurposed for a king, either Akhenaten or Smenkhare. Unfortunately, the king's names were erased during the abandoned clearance job carried out, possibly in late Ramesside times. The epithets were appropriate to Akhenaten, but also included one more appropriate to a person who was beloved of Akhenaten. The epithet might have belonged to the original owner, but if it was reused for the new owner, it would suggest that Akhenaten was not that new owner of the coffin. This is all, however, a great deal to read into something more likely to have been overlooked in the complicated job of adapting the inscriptions. It would be more appropriate to say that the coffin was reused for Akhenaten or Smenkhare, but it's not possible to say which, and nor would either necessarily determine whose body was in the coffin. There was nothing radical or unusual about reusing coffins and canopic jars. Why some of Kia's equipage was available at this stage is unknown, but possible contexts are either that her burial equipment had never been used, or a general clearance of Amarna tombs during Tutankhamun's reign. There were several important pieces found in Tutankhamun's tomb that had manifestly been relabeled for his use, especially the second coffin and miniature coffins used for his viscera. Royal tombs were in any case generally likely to contain heirloom items. Akhenaten's Amarna tomb contained a diorite bowl of the 4th dynasty king Khafre, as well as other more recent family antiques. Other New Kingdom royal tombs contained pieces bearing the names of predecessors. Armed with this information, it's possible to imagine some of what might have happened. On Tutankhamun's instructions, Tiye and Akhenaten were removed from the royal tomb at Amarna together with portable burial equipage drawn from their original interment, together with other available pieces which might have included some of Kia's. They were taken to Thebes and reburied in KV55. At this stage, the name of the Aten does not seem to have troubled the reburial team unduly. When Tutankhamun died a decade or so later, several items chosen for his tomb still bore the Aten's name, such as the throne. Some effort was made to create a conventional 18th dynasty burial in KV55, hence the magic bricks and the omission of anything new to do with the Aten, including Akhenaten's birth name. KV55 was undecorated, which makes it likely the tomb already existed and was unused, and therefore the reburials were relatively hasty and ad hoc. Crucially, none of this precludes the possibility that other individuals were buried in KV55 at this time, but no evidence survives of their presence in any form, unless the unidentified body is not Akhenaten's. Later, the tomb was rediscovered. The most likely occasion was when the tomb of Ramesses IX, KV6, only a few metres away, was being dug out around 1120 BC towards the end of the 20th dynasty. This was an unsettled period when tomb robbing was well established and around the time that caches of royal mummies were being created. Regardless of when the tomb was found, Tiye's mummy was removed, along with some of her grave goods bought from Amarna. She, if her body has been correctly identified, subsequently ended up in the cache in Amenhotep II's tomb, KV35, but possibly only after a sojourn in Amenhotep III's tomb, WV22, in the Western Valley. The working party left no surviving record of, and thus no explanation for, their visit, but had evidently been instructed to clear the tomb. It must have been realised immediately that the contents included material from the Amarna period. The men were armed with enough information to be able to pick out anything with Akhenaten's name on it. The task force gave up on Tiye's shrine. They left the dismantled panels where they fell, but defaced them, if they had not been already, removing Akhenaten's name and his figure. They also abandoned the male body, which they did not damage in the search for valuables. Instead, they removed the names on the coffin and symbols of royalty from the mummy. If the body was not already in the coffin, this was when it was put there. If there were any other bodies, they were taken away and left no trace. These activities and the fact that gold, including decorative elements of the coffin, was left behind, show that the men concerned were not thieves and must have been acting in an official capacity. If the suggested date is correct, the partial clearance of KV55 took place 2 centuries, or thereabouts, after Akhenaten's death. By then his name and Smenkhare's had long been omitted from any official records, but the treatment of KV55 shows that Akhenaten's reputation had survived. However, knowledge of the Amarna period was probably patchy. This makes it possible, even likely, that those emptying KV55 was uncertain of the identity of the male body or made a mistaken assumption, confused by the various names found on different items in the tomb. Their plan appears to have been to leave the body isolated and nameless, but not to desecrate it. We are therefore left only with what the task force decided to leave in KV55. The centrepiece is the enigmatic mummy, reduced to a skeleton by the time the tomb was discovered in 1907. Enough survives to be certain that it is that of an adult male. The body was described at the time of discovery as having an abnormal pelvis, which led to an initial assumption it was female and thus Tiye's. There's no doubt that the body was that of a key member of the royal family and was closely related to Tutankhamun, sharing a blood group and physical appearance, which included the pelvis. Once T was discounted as a candidate for the body, there were very few possibilities left. One was Akhenaten. No physical remains had been found in the royal tomb at Amarna, while the magic bricks made it possible, even likely, that his body, or a body believed to be his, had been reburied in K-55 at some point. By default, Smenkhare is the only alternative candidate to Akhenaten that we know of. As the most shadowy figure in the whole saga, Smenkhare remains a persistent enigma. The only circumstantial physical inference we can draw from what we know about Smenkhare is that he was younger than Akhenaten and was related to Tutankhamun. He had no known tomb at Amarna. Nothing left in KV55 belonged to him, and even the material in Tutankhamun's tomb that might have been his is not demonstrably so. Without the unidentified body and the deleted names on the coffin, there would never have been any suggestion that Smenkhare had been buried in KV55. Instead, it would have been assumed that his tomb, like those of all Akhenaten's daughters except Mekhetaten, had not been found and that the body was Akhenaten's. With no certain three-dimensional sculpture of Smenkhare, it's impossible reliably to compare the skull with representations of him and Akhenaten. The plaster bust from the Amarna workshop of Thutmose, sometimes identified as Smenkhare, is not labelled. It closely resembles busts of Akhenaten, which means that even if the bust is of Smenkhare, then the two men looked so like each other, no firm conclusion could ever be drawn either way. That is also a consequence of Amarna art, in which Akhenaten's features were likely to be reflected in representations of other family members. The entire identification debate has been a long-running saga, based entirely around the estimated age at death and most recently DNA. Although a modest consensus has emerged of late that the body is that of a young man aged about 22 at most, those in favour of the body being Akhenaten's have simply resorted to arguing that Akhenaten's entire career and revolution was packed into his late childhood and adolescence, involving further complications. Anyone who starts reading the relevant literature will be confounded by the claims and counterclaims, almost entirely driven by the personal preference of the expert involved for Akhenaten or Smenkhare. No technique or observation which includes examination of the bones, for example the fusion of the epiphyses and teeth, has led to an unequivocal conclusion, compounded by the fact that we have no idea how old Akhenaten was when he died, or whether Smenkhare was his brother or son, or related in some other way. Nor does any of the physiological or DNA evidence affect the view that, whether the body is Akhenaten's or not, it would still be the case that Tutankhamun was most likely to be Akhenaten's son. Like a gun without a serial number left beside a murder victim, the unidentified body in KV55 only leads back to itself. The evidence needed to answer the question conclusively has either not survived or has not yet been found. After all, the whole intention seems to have been to deny the body its identity, a job that was done very efficiently. Clearly, there is something very wrong, either with our understanding of what might have happened, or the body, or both. This is not least because the assemblage as found was not the burial in its original form, but was how the body had been rearranged and left by the task force charged with clearing it. Therefore, the endlessly recycled arguments in favour of the body being either Akhenaten or Smenkhare have gone everywhere and got nowhere. It's fascinating that the problem even exists and the hold it seems to have over the study of the period. There are few other historical contexts in which so much has been invested. In the hopeless task of trying to identify the unnamed body of a member of the ruling house, and in the belief that to do so will transform our knowledge of events. Nor would it normally even be possible to try. There is, for example, no available body belonging to any Roman emperor or members of his family. The worst of all outcomes, which is a frequent characteristic of the KV55 mystery, is to contort what little is known about the history of this brief period in any way possible to match any one of the various theories about the body. The case of the skeleton of England's King Richard III, reigned 1483-5, found in Leicester in 2012, makes for a sobering comparison. Like the KV55 body, it was not labelled, but written evidence provided information about his scoliosis of the spine, age at death, place and cause of death, post-mortem injury and burial location, which all matched the remains. Paintings also provided a basis for Richard's physical appearance. The DNA evidence obviously did not name the skeleton, but was compatible with descent from Richard's mother. There was also, crucially, no alternative candidate for the body. The weight of all these factors made its identification as Richard III's remains overwhelmingly probable and illustrate precisely why the KV55 debate has got nowhere, because most of these corroborating factors are not available. Those obsessed with KV55's human remains consequently missed the point, which would be to approach the problem as if the body had never been found. Since neither Akhenaten nor Smenkhare, whoever or whatever he was, played any further part in Egyptian history, both had either died or disappeared by this time. Therefore, the identity of the bones in KV55 doesn't matter. Anyone who chooses to pursue the musical tomb story of KV55 will find that the arguments say far more about Egyptology, and certain Egyptologists, than they do about the events and personalities enshrined in its rotted contents. In summary, the short period between the indisputable facts of Akhenaten's death and Tutankhamun's accession only served to inject a minor delay in ending the Amarna period. Just one juvenile royal male eligible on dynastic grounds to rule was left. That's the overwhelming historical certainty which needs focusing on. This turn of events rendered the possible fleeting tenure of the throne by any intermediaries after Akhenaten all their actions, neither here nor there.